morning, Chair Parker, members of the board, Commissioner Mercer. My name is Jeff Parker. I'm with the Office of Commissioner. I'm going to lead off today's deliberative session with just a little bit of an introduction, follow up on Cindy's discussion of statutory criteria. I think Cindy did a great job going through there. Remember, the key thing is there are 9 or 10 statutory criteria that our rules will provide the detail. How are we going to make a determination that when we get an application for an advanced exploration or mining permit, that the applicant has met and satisfied each and every one of these statutory criteria? It really is kind of the devil is in the details, and what the rule does is provides the details on how we are going to process and make a determination whether each and every one of these statutory criteria is met. First off, I think it'd be important and very useful for the board to have an overview of the mining process. Really, what does mining involve? And I think we have some graphics here, and I'm asking Mark to provide a brief overview of what is the mining process? How does this work?
Okay, I think it's going to be closer to the top, Melanie. Probably slide 2.
There we go.
Thank you. Chairman Parker, members of the board,
Commissioner.
Another one.
I'll try this one.
Yeah, that one might work. Can you hear me okay now?
Awesome.
Chairman Parker, members of the board, Commissioner Mercer, Mark Stebbins, mining coordinator with the Maine DEP. What you see on that slide right there is a very simplified process flow chart for mining. I had presented this chart back in August when we had were posting the rule. I went through this step by step with some slides to show you different types of processes used. As far as the mine, there's really only two types of mines that you can have out there. It's either an open pit or an underground shaft mining. And the rule as written contains certain standards and design standards for those operations, obviously blasting standards, those things. As soon as the rock is removed, you have to crush it. It's a three-step process where you have a primary jaw, takes big rock, makes it smaller, a milling process that takes it down into a smaller particle size, and then into a ball mill that takes it down into like a fine sand so you can process that through an ore separation method, which would typically be flotation. It could be gravity. Most of the ones I've seen have been flotation cells. They're usually in a series, and each tank, as it goes through each tank, the concentrate gets a little bit more grade as you go down to the end. And then at the end of that process, you have to dewater that so you can get a concentrate to ship. Mining is a tremendous consumer of water because that is how they separate most of the minerals. So there's a component as far as water management for that mine plan beneficiation. That's the fancy term for how you're going to get the metal out of the rock. And we do require a plan in this rule that tells us all the reagents that you're going to use, how you're going to do it, what are you going to do with all the waste, how is that waste designed. So that's a real quick overview of the sort of the broad steps in there. We're going to take you through as this session goes through today in more detail about components mostly. With what you see up there is the tailings management facility. We're going to have a lot of discussion about that today and some of the waste rock that you see on the far right. Obviously, you got to process a lot of rock to get material that you want. So there's a huge amount of waste rock and just a small portion of rock that actually contains the mineralization that you're trying to get. That's pretty much it in a nutshell as far as the flow chart. If you have questions, I can certainly do my best to answer those for you.
In any mining process, most of the activities done on site, or is the rock transported off site to a facility that can, say, better manage not only the rock but the water that's needed for the separation and refinement of
That's a great question. I've actually seen it in a couple different scenarios. I've seen these beneficiation plants, concentrated plants, on site with material, because obviously transportation cost adds a lot if you're traveling a distance to go to an off-site processing facility. Most of the time you see those plants right at the mine site. I have seen some mines with a facility. They might be revamping an older facility that could be 30, 40, 50 miles away, where they've actually revamped those facilities and made them the beneficiation plant. So it can go either way. Most of the time you'll see it right on the mine site, depending on the location, what you have. Could depend on the infrastructure, because obviously you need power, you need roads to get the product from one spot to the other. So it could be either way. I've seen them both ways throughout the country. Most of the time on site is what I've seen.
Thanks.
Following up on that theme, when I think of mining, just something for rock, crushed rock, can rock be taken off site for other uses?
Most of the time you're going to see rock from off site coming in to develop a mine site, because it takes a large volume of rock to build these facilities. So you may have an off-site aggregate quarry or road building, so it's things like that. We do require whatever is brought onto site or whatever you're mining out has to be tested, so we know if it's reactive or not. Some of the facilities I've been to, they're looking continuously for aggregate sources, so they can use it for either backfilling an underground mine or for building infrastructure for all these facilities, either a tailings management facility, being a ore storage building with a pad has to be a certain thickness, has to be built so it can withstand loads and weights. So it could be, you could have off-site stuff come 30 miles away.
And maybe you're going to get into this in more detail later, but we heard a lot during the public hearing of concerns about wet mine tailing storage, if I'm using the correct terminology. Can you give us a little information on alternatives to that? Is that essentially the only option that most mines have, or is there alternatives to that storage process?
We are going to get into that in a little bit more detail. I can try to go through it now, or we can go through this outline. Dave's here to help me out with tailings facilities. I mean, there is a variety of methods out there as far as a tailings facility that could have a slurry type. As I mentioned, that the process to float minerals, it's a tremendous use of water. And one method for that rock to come out, it comes out into a slurry, maybe 30% tailings, 70% water that has to go into a disposal facility. That would technically, by our classification, be a wet waste mine unit. Then I've seen facilities that have where they use a dewatering process before the tailings are discharged. Essentially, it could be like a filter press or a vacuum belt where the moisture, the water is squeezed out of the tailings. I mean, it's not totally dry, we use that term, but it could have anywhere up to 20% moisture left. Typically, when you see that kind of facility, you have an increased cost as far as like trucking, because it's not a slurry anymore, it's not pump gravity. Usually on a tailing slurry, they just gravity pump it to a facility. If it's a dewatered tailings, it's either transported by truck or by conveyor. And it typically goes into like a landfill design. Dave can provide you a lot more detail on those kind of designs, but those are typically what you see. And there's always something in between. I mean, you got a slurry, you got a dry, and in the middle, it might be a thickening tailings or something like that, where the moisture content, more water is squeezed out. So you can run the gamut. Slurry, dry, thickened tailings in the middle.
No questions?
With respect to other licenses that may need to be issued, you indicated that there's a lot of water used on the site, and you have a beneficiation facility perhaps that may have air emissions concerns associated with that. How are they dealt with in this process? They're not talked about in this particular rule, other than the need to address them.
That's correct. There may be other activities in the PIP that require a separate permit other than a mining permit. For example, if they are having, if there is, obviously there will be a beneficiation plan or a concentrated plan. If they need to discharge wastewater, that would require a separate license under our waste discharge licenses. It's called the NEPTES permit. If they discharge to groundwater from these plants, because we're in Maine, so we have tremendous amount of rainfall. We're not in Nevada. It's a dry state. They may need to discharge treated water. There are restrictions as far as discharge to some streams in Maine, Class A or Double A. Class A, you can't Double A, you can't discharge to a Class A. It's got to be equal to or better than. That's a pretty high standard. A lot of times you may see them using some type of infiltration to a groundwater. That actually requires a discharge license through a water bureau. Those are typically, that's a federal program. We have jurisdiction to issue those license. And there's a slew, as Cindy had mentioned earlier, about the water quality standards that you have to meet for those. But it is a separate license process. As far as air license, let's say you're up in the middle of nowhere and you need to generate power. So if there's generators and those sorts of things on site, it's probably going to require an air emission license for those types of equipment. If they're going to relocate maybe a stream or if they're going to fill wetland, that's a separate permit under the Natural Resources Act. When you go back to the Mining Act, it kind of lists those permits that were consolidated, and then it lists those permits that were not consolidated. So waste discharge is separate. Natural Resources Protection Act is a separate permit. An air emission license is a separate permit.
What about dust that's created in that, rather than from the generators or the power?
Well, it's, we do have a dust standard in the rule. I mean, obviously, a lot of times the crushing facilities are totally enclosed. Some of the facilities that I have seen were totally enclosed buildings with filter systems, bag houses to take that out. That may require an air emission license. As far as some of the waste units, like tailings, I mean, obviously, if you got a slurry type, dust isn't an issue, but if it's a dry tailings, it means obviously exposed for a while, it gets dried, you could have dust issues coming off those types of structures. We do have some standards in this rule in subchapter 5 that kind of lays out those standards to reduce dust. I mean, dust can be an issue depending on what type of facility that you have.
Great. Thanks, Mark. Next, I'd like to move on to really discuss, actually, Mark's question with respect to waste characterization, waste management, and storage and groundwater contamination. So I think it'd be really helpful to look at our site map of a mining site. And we do have both one with an open pit and a shaft, but not on the same site, though. Thanks, but not on the same site. So I'm going to turn it back to Mark, and again, we're going to try to provide an overview of the technical issues and basis behind the waste characterization management, including wet storage, dry storage, and then we're going to move on to some of the other issues where I'll be able to update you on siting and financial assurance capacity. But this issue of waste characterization and management is really a seminal issue behind the rule and a major concern of the public and the board, and also establishes a base, if you will, for where we go from here. Thank you.
In this diagram, it's just very general schematic of what you see as far as you got the tailings pile, waste rock storage. As I mentioned, obviously you have a waste associated with processing. to get the metal out of the rock. And there's some rock that doesn't have metal content or may have a metal content that you can't get the minerals out that you need. You will have storage facilities for the ore. It could be an outpad. It could be enclosed in a building. I've seen a lot of the newer facilities that I'm seeing, everything's enclosed inside to keep rain water off the site. This slide also shows the mill site, and it shows a mining portal. In this case, it's an underground mine. I do have another slide that shows the open pit. What you'll see here, you'll see the mining areas defined, which is a defined term in the statute that says it's pretty much where the facilities are located. It could be a waste management facility, it could be buildings, it could be storage piles, it could be maintenance garages. And then what we have is the affected area, which is those parts of the mine site that don't have any actual development on it. Let's see if we can go to the classification, which would be three slides down, Melanie, that one. In the rule, and this has been in the rule since we developed the 91 rules, it's probably the nuts and bolts of this whole rulemaking efforts. What do we have? What kind of rock do we have? And how do we know what we're going to get after we take it out? If we don't know, we can't characterize a rock. And when I'm talking about characterization, the big thing is we're trying to figure out, is it an acid producer or not? I think you've heard testimony, and a lot of people talk about metal sulfides. When you kind of expose it to air and water, you have that potential to generate acid. That acid leaches metals out, and that can be a problem as far as the receiving environment. Our rule from the get-go in 91 right up to present day has required mine waste characterization. Essentially what that is, everything that they encounter in the mine site as far as the different geologic units that they go through has to be tested to determine, is it an acid producer or not? And we do static tests on that. So it's a yes or no. Then we also require all that rock that's an acid producer to be tested again through what we call a kinetic test. So essentially that tells us what the drainage quality may be at the end, and that's a long-term kind of test. They're usually in a column, it's in a lab. You have material, could be drill core material, waste rock. They'll have alternate drying periods, wetting periods. They'll take like deionized water after several days, pour it through the column, collect the leachate, analyze what's coming out at the end. And that's really key, because we classify, if it's an acid producer, we call it a group A waste. And there are certain design requirements for what we call a group A waste, which is an acid producer or a waste that displays a hazardous waste component. A class B waste would be, it's not an acid producer, but there may be something else. It may leach metals at a higher pH, maybe at 6 or 7. Some metals are still mobile at that time. And we have certain design requirements for that. So each unit that's classified, as I mentioned, we've got specific design standards for those units, and Dave's going to take you through those in just a second. This waste characterization that we're talking about, we actually developed it, as I said, back in 1990. It was based on some of the work that was done in British Columbia, which was the draft acid rock drainage technical guide and the British Columbia Acid Mine Drainage Task Force. And it's pretty much universal now. Most jurisdictions in the United States and Canada requires that the mine waste be characterized to see if it's an acid producer or not. If it's an acid producer, then you have to have the appropriate designs. And depending on how it's classified, our financial assurance requirements in this rule require monies to make sure that those facilities are designed right and for catastrophic events, those sorts of things. We've used this approach twice in the past. We did it for back in the early 90s for an advanced exploration project here in the state. That was the West Forks Alder Pond project, where we actually classified all the waste. We wrote a license. We had design standards for the ore storage pad. It wasn't beneficiation. They were just going in to grab what we call a bulk sample, of the ore so they could test it to see what the recovery grades were. And then we used it again in 97 for the Blackhawk application, which was for Bald Mountain, which was a scaled-down version. They're just going to mine the Gaussian cap and the supergene, the copper. All that rock was classified, and they based their design on how that rock was classified. So it's been used twice. It's been used twice successfully here in the state. As I said, it's pretty much universal out there as far as other regulatory jurisdictions. Dave, did you want to go through?
Can I ask a question for everyone?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Mark, I don't know that such a thing actually exists at this point, but when you're classifying the rock characteristics with regard to whether they are acid producers or not, is there any, do you have any knowledge of classifying the ambient air conditions for acid, since virtually all rain, with the exception of in proximity of smokestacks that are highly alkaline, but all natural rain is carbonic acid. It is an acid. And when it lands on various rocks that can be changed chemically by virtue of the acidity that's happening while we speak today in the forests of Maine and beyond, I just didn't know whether there would be a, so almost like a, what is the standard, if there is such a thing, a carbon dioxide level and the production of carbonic acid, which occurs with water plus CO2, yields H2CO3, that's the carbonic acid. And I don't know, because I haven't really looked for it yet, to see if that's of any concern. But because when you're measuring the excavated rock material for its acidity potential, to what extent does a wet atmosphere over a period of time, seasonally perhaps, change the possibility of increasing, or I don't decreasing, but increasing the level of the acidity by virtue of the rainfall?
I don't think we have anything specific in the rule that deals with that. I mean, as part of that characterization, we do require a mine waste characterization plan, and in there we have a very general standard that says, you got to look at the short and long-term acid producing potential, the distribution of the particle size as far as tailings and waste rock, that kind of stuff. Neutralizing effects of host materials. When I talk about host materials, those are the other rock units. And we do have something in here that says the effects of weathering. So, I mean, it's very general in there. I mean, if we do have a low pH rain, I mean, I'm assuming you could run some of these tests, kinetic tests.
For a simulated rainfall.
Yeah, simulated rainfall.
Thank you, John.
Good morning, Chairman Parker, board members, Commissioner Mercer, David Burns, Acting Director, Bureau of Remediation and Waste Management. I just wanted to talk for a few minutes with you about containment structures, what they consist of, what their designs might be. And Mark did a great job setting the table for me in terms of the containment structure designs are a function of the mine waste characterization. As he mentioned, the Group A, Group B, Group C waste all will have different standards associated with their design. So containment structures include things like tailings impoundments, water impoundments, and other on-site constructed tanks and containment units. They're meant to be engineered structures. The design of these units, there are several performance standards that they need to meet before we get into the details of the design. They must be designed to prevent overtopping during the probable maximum flood. They go through a fairly extensive stability analysis that's similar to, I come out of the solid waste side of things, so similar to what we would do on the solid waste side, where you're looking at potential failure planes of the units. There are requirements for minimum factors of safety, both under static conditions and seismic conditions, during construction periods, during operation periods, and during post-closure periods. So we look at all of those events. They must have adequate slope protection. You must evaluate liquefaction during seismic events. And they have to be designed to accommodate a 24-hour, 500-year storm event as well. The various waste units just moving through the, what the design might look like. So if you had a Group A mine waste, that's the, again, the acid-producing or hazardous characteristic type material, that's going to have a composite liner system, which is a synthetic liner along with compacted soils behind it. There is required to be a leachate collection system on top of that, designed to keep leachate to 12 inches or less on your liner system. Again, we do that to prevent head buildup on a liner, which would drive contaminants through if you allow too much to build up, or it could. It has more potential. The liner material, if anyone's familiar with high-density polyethylene, it's a 60-mil material. It's fairly thin, but it's sort of the gold standard in the waste industry of materials to utilize. We would look at compatibility with the various waste streams to make sure that it was the appropriate material, but typically that's what we see. For the next tier down, the Group B mine waste, that is just a compacted soil material compacted to a hydraulic conductivity of 1 times 10 to the minus 7 centimeters per second. That's consistent with the hydraulic conductivities in the waste industry. It's very achievable. It requires either a recompacted clay material or a till material that's compacted. The leachate ponds that would be associated with these facilities would have a similar composite liner to the Group A waste that we spoke about. And we also have provisions in here that if stabilization of the Group A or Group B mine waste are not adequate to prevent potential releases, we can require a leak detection system beneath the primary liner. So that would be the telltale first sign of how your liner was performing. We also included in the rules a alternative design process. So we set up minimum standards. This is a performance-based rule. And if somebody has a situation where an alternative design may be appropriate, as long as they can demonstrate that it's technically equivalent or superior to what is in the rule, they can propose that. We could analyze it and allow that potential option. I know there's been a lot of discussion about wet waste units. Different types of tailings impoundments and what they mean, and as Mark mentioned, it does span the spectrum from dry to wet and everything in between. In response to concerns that have been expressed in the past, we made a compromise in this particular rule and allowed wet waste units during the operating stage of a mine. At the time of closure, they're not allowed anymore. So that was a particular compromise in response to comments that we took. Wet waste units, first, let me say, it's not for all different waste. It can be a desirable feature for high acid producing material. Basically, by having a water cover over the top, it cuts off oxygen diffusion, which is one of the components of producing acid rock drainage. These would be in lined facilities. The embankments would be designed to be structurally stable as we just went through. There has to be water control and there has to be prevention of overtopping of the unit so that you don't have a embankment failure due to overtopping of the water. By putting it in the rule the way we did, that it's allowed during operations but needs to transition at the time of closure, there's going to have to be a design and a process for transitioning a wet waste unit from its wet state to a longer-term stable dry state. So that would be discussed at the time of permit application as well. Anybody who proposed a wet waste unit would have to demonstrate how they're going to do this. This is not necessarily an easy thing to do. there are particular options that one could imagine could be used. Things like use of wick drains. They're a synthetic material wrapped with a geotextile component. They're meant to transmit water vertically in the upward direction. If you put a load on top, it will transmit water up. It's a way to dewater the waste. You could also do a vacuum suction on it. Those are possible options. As we experienced down at Callahan, we can drill horizontal drains in. Those were also done at the Elizabeth Mine in Vermont. At Callahan, it's too early to say that it's going to be successful. It's not drawing it down a lot, but we've learned a lot from that experience and would intend to do more. At the Elizabeth Mine, it was fairly successful. They put in a number of drains. So that is one way to dewater as well. You could put in a series of well points and pump. And again, this is going to take time. So that time to transition between being a wet waste unit and truly being closed, it's going to be a period of time. I can't say without a specific design in front of me how many years, but it's important to understand that it's a process that you'll be moving through to reach a more stable, traditional dry cover. Other options, you know, if we go to the other end of the spectrum that Mark mentioned, you have the dry stack tailings. Those are more what you would consider a conventional landfilling technique. There's certainly the filter press and vacuum presses that could be used to dry the waste. It then has to be transported to tailings containment structure. It would be put in a fairly dry state and spread. It will be subject to precipitation and other climatic conditions. It will need to be graded so that it doesn't resaturate. You know, I think it absolutely can work in a humid climate, but I think those are more traditionally, maybe Mark can speak more, in an arid climate, you would see that sort of approach. That's kind of the spectrum on the tailings from wet to dry. So I don't know if you want to stop and ask questions before we get too much farther along.
One question, sort of follow up to has a potential of containing a lot of residual minerals and things of that nature. Are those going to end up having to be landfilled and closed under a permanent cover to keep the acid rain from long-term leaching those?
If they have any acid-producing potential, yes, they would be in the same line unit that we're talking about for tailings impoundments.
Now, could that include almost all the excavated rock?
No, I wouldn't say we include all the excavated rock. The testing that Mark referred to will tell us what the acid-producing potential is and the risk associated with it. Metals can leach out. We would also look at that. If it was a metals issue, then yes, it would have to be in a closed cell. But if it doesn't have a metals issue or an acid-producing potential, no, it wouldn't be.
I think similar question actually. It just you talked about the impoundment structure and whether it needs to be lined with HDPE or not, in the process of taking a wet unit and making it dry. But I guess I'm making an assumption and looking for clarification that at some point when the mine is closed, a cover is put over that facility to prevent precipitation from infiltrating.
That's correct. That would be necessary.
If I understand right, now that the legislature changed, you only get one permit, you know, and the permit is good for the life of the mine. Is that correct? So who decides the mine's closed, that now we have to go from wet to dry?
One, the permit, the mining permit actually is for the life of the mine, LOM, life of the mine.
Right.
As far as the closure, as part of the application package submitted to the department, there is a requirement for the closure plan. That's kind of like it's not a static document. It may change as they go through operations because you can continual testing that material all the way through. It just doesn't start at the beginning. You're going to test the material all the way through to see how it reacts and stuff. So we do require that closure plan. It tells us how each unit is going to be closed, the time, and how you're going to do it. All those methods are included. As we go through, towards the end, a mine may only have a 7-year life. It could have a 30-year life, depending on how big the deposit is. But we do require those plans, closure plans, to be submitted.
Just back to what, I mean, how much activity do they have to have to say that the mine's still open? So what I'm driving at is, okay, it must be a tremendous cost going from wet to dry. Is it cheaper to keep the mine open at a very, very small operation to say that mine is still open so that they don't have to go from wet to dry?
I think there's some in the back as far as in the closure requirements. I think we have some standards in there that says when it's closed. I mean, essentially, if you're not taking any more rock out and processing it, essentially you're going to start initiating closure requirements. There could be a series of mine waste units that might be closed in maybe year 3, year 5, year 10, depending on how big they are. They have to go smaller. But there are requirements as far as closure. Let me see if I can find those real quick. They're going to be in the closure and post-closure maintenance requirements starting in section 24. I have it on page 81 of mine.
Page 232.
232, and thank you for your board packet. I'm just going down through here. Here's the requirements for the closure plan. There's a 5-year interval. Design requirements. Let's see what we got. Closure trigger right here. It's under 24A4. I got that right. You'll see some of the closure. Closure must begin if the preceding 12 months the mine waste unit has not received disposal of more than 10% of the annual volume of waste. Okay. So there's the trigger. So there's something in there that says, okay, let's look at the closure plan. You've reached this value. How's this all going to work?
Thank you.
Yeah, and we wouldn't be waiting for the end at most of these facilities for closure. It would be a sequential closure as units were filled up and moved on to the next one. But ultimately, there is a closure certification required that they submit to us.
During that period, even if they haven't quite broken that 10%, they still have to maintain all the facilities of the mine, don't they, and meet all the environmental requirements that are placed on that permit.
That's correct.
If not, then you go to the security to do what's going to be done.
What happens if you encounter, or the mine encounters material, metals that that they maybe are small enough that they can't recover, yet pose a significant environmental issue if left exposed or behind after the mine is closed? Or do you deal with that right up front when you start doing the initial evaluation of the, or characterization of material?
That's a good question. As I had mentioned earlier in that mine waste characterization, we require all the rock to be tested. Typically, they're testing the drill core, goes through the ore body and the different other units, or rock units that are there, to see what kind of waste we have. Is it reactive or not? As I had mentioned, that's an ongoing process, not just at the beginning. That waste characterization will be required through the operating life of the mine. Whatever units they get, they got to know how to deal with it. What do I have? Is it an acid producer? If it is, it's got to go to this design. If it's not, it goes to this unit, which may have a, not the, all the nuts and bolts, but like leachate collection and stuff like that. But we require testing throughout the life of the mine as far as the rock units that they encounter.
Would you ever deny a permit if you found something that was, say, if all of a sudden they encountered uranium?
That's a good question, because uranium mining is not allowed in the state. That's actually prohibited by statute.
What happens is if that's there,
Well, hopefully, as part of that mine waste characterization, we do require like a whole rock analysis that will tell us each component, and John can help me out here. Uranium, to me, is typically associated with some of the granitic-type plutons. Most of the metal deposits that we have here in the state are volcanic-type rocks, metasedimentary, those sort of things. I mean, we would require, as I said, all rock to be tested, and that includes rock being brought in from off-site, because you don't want to be surprised all of a sudden if you're looking at the drainage quality of something. If you didn't test a rock coming in from like an aggregate quarry, and all of a sudden you have a spike in one of the parameters that you're monitoring, it's like, okay, where's it coming from? So everything has to be tested, whether it's on-site through the mining or if you're bringing in a source rock to build a facility.
So if you find that, what is the reaction to that? I mean, if you say, stop doing what you're doing, do you have a process for controlling this?
We do require a contingency plan as part of the application. That might be one of those issues that you look at. What if we hit something that we didn't think we were going to hit, like uranium or thorium, because that's also prohibited by statute, and how we're going to deal with that. That may be something, if you hit a rock unit that has that, you may have to go around it and leave it alone. That would be the alternative, if you don't mind it.
Thanks. I want to add a little bit to that. You know, through these processes, both in the past and currently, you know, we have received comments.
Yeah. Sorry, before we go on, we're going to just follow up. I have a question.
Yes, I'm following up with Mark's.
And then I'll
and yes. Okay. Yeah, we have received some comments suggesting that we incorporate a go/no-go provision, which I think it's relevant to your question. So if an applicant submits an application and, in fact, there is uranium or something, would we or do we have the authority to deny a permit? Section 490.00B, I believe, 4B, of the framework law, one of the approval criteria says the applicant must have made adequate provisions for fitting the mining operation harmoniously into the existing natural environment, and the development will not unreasonably adversely affect existing uses, scenic character, air quality, water quality, or other natural resources. So I think, you know, there's certainly the legislature likely anticipated that kind of a scenario. There might be situations where mining simply is too dangerous, but I think it would probably best fall under the analysis of alternatives or alternatives analysis section of Section 9 of the rule. So we could look at that.
Wet and dry waste, mine waste unit issue. If one is converting from the wet to the dry, say if you had allowed a tailings lagoon and at the end of the life of the mine, is that material then going into something akin to like a solid waste or a hazardous waste landfill? Is it going to be designed in that sort of way?
I would envision, and this would be up to an individual permittee as to how they want to approach this, but I would envision that you are doing your consolidation of the material or drying of the material in the unit that it's in. So the liquid that's coming off is going to treatment. So eventually it would stay in the same unit, essentially.
So if one had a lagoon, you would essentially dry that out, and then I think Mr. Draper's question, would that then be capped in some sort of way?
Yes.
That would, and you may then, and the lagoon probably has some underdrains initially, or?
Well, lagoon is going to be lined. Right. The impoundment containment structure is going to be lined. It may or may not have a leak detection system, again, depending on
level of risk associated with it and the needs of that facility. So that liner system will always be there in place. You will be essentially drawing liquid out of the material. And when you do that, the material is going to consolidate, and then you would put a cover over the top of that.
And then another question, would if one just had an open pit at the end of the day or an open shaft when one was ceasing mining, if that simply is allowed to fill with water, because it's very deep, I imagine water is going to come into that pit or shaft over time, is that a wet mine waste unit, or is that something that's allowed to remain just filled with water, even if you've been required to transition from wet to dry?
We're going to tag team on this one, because the pit in mining in Maine, chances are that water is going to fill a pit back up or shaft back up. That's just the fact of where the groundwater levels are in the state of Maine. Whether or not that would ultimately be considered a wet waste unit, I think is maybe Mark has some opinions on that, but that is something to be considered by the board. What do you want to call this?
And I agree with David. We've had this conversation because, as David just mentioned, if you have an open pit mine and you're pretty much deeper than 30 or 50 feet, you're going to get groundwater at the end. That pit will flood. The only way it won't flood is if you continue to pump it. Obviously, you're not going to be able to close the mine if you have to continue to pump water down. Same with a shaft. A shaft typically requires dewatering. That water is typically treated. Discharge at the end, those workings that you get flooded, or in some cases, the underground workings are backfilled with waste rock. And I've seen some backfilled with tailings. Usually, they're using an additive like concrete for stability to the mine shafts. But it's interesting that is it a wet waste mine unit? If you look at the definition, it only says that's the class A waste, okay, group A waste. It's going to flood. I can't tell you anything other. If it's an open pit, it's going to flood. Unless you take some of the materials, we talked about you only to use wet covers temporarily, as far as like an engineered structure. You may move that waste from whatever temporary design that you have back to the mine pit for backfill. Could be blended with some other materials, such as limestone or something, and covered that way. It can be built so it's above the groundwater level. I mean, I've seen some proposals out there in Canada and U.S. as far as taking waste rock and some of your dry tailings, thickened tailings, and put it back in the mine pit. You have a temporary storage unit, and at the end, it's not transporting anything back to the open pit. So it's a really tough question. Would I call it a wet waste mine unit? I've been going back and forth. I would call it a flooded mine working as part of the closure. It's the same thing with any other quarry that I have in the state. The minute the pumps are shut off, it fills up. Thompson, Dragon Plant, when that quarry's done, it's below sea level right now, the pumps stop, it's going to fill up to the level where the groundwater was before. But that's it. I would put that decision back to what you want to call it. It's really tough. That's a tough one. Would I call it West Main? Probably not. Call it part of closure, flooding. I think we can maybe tweak some things in the rules that might help out. But we've been wrestling with that for a while.
Have you considered the pre-mining groundwater characteristics in relationship to the post-mining groundwater characteristics and some ratio of treating the groundwater to the extent that it would be ideal, that it would be the same chemical level as the pre-mining groundwater is and was before anything happened there. In other words, to anticipate the absence, complete absence of some chemical characteristics of the groundwater as a result of the mining facility, there's already the existence of some chemistry that needs to be well documented before the very first exploration and or other extraction occurs, because you need to know what's the groundwater like there now. And then if we know that, then we compare it to what it would be ideally when we completed this dry, wet, whatever it's going to be, thing. And it seemed to me that you put some type of thing together that says basically you either got to equal or come within some range of equaling what the original groundwater characteristics were like by nature. What do you think?
We do require, obviously, baseline to see what the groundwater quality is at the beginning. And we do require what the in-pit groundwater quality will be like if it's an open-pit mine. You got to test, as I mentioned, we test all the rock units. Some areas of that open pit may still have reactive rock. It may not, it may be totally mined out. It could be parts of the open pit that you don't mine because it's so reactive, you go around it. It could be parts of that open pit that could be backfilled with materials, some kind of blending materials that give it a neutralizing potential to kind of stop the acid production. But we do require both at the beginning, at the end, what is going to be the water quality of that pit, and is it going to require treatment? And if you recall, we only allow treatment 10 years after post-closure. And filling up the mine pit is not something that happens in one day. It takes years and years and years for that groundwater inflow to come back and to fill up. Do you have anything to add?
I think we'll kind of get to that.
Are you going to get to that?
Does that help?
Just have one follow-up question, but more importantly, the last 45 minutes were more educational for me than probably all of the moments we've had together here. Just wanted to thank you for that. You said, I think your question earlier, Tom, was about closure, and your answer was about 10% of the mining would trigger a closure. 10% of what?
It's the throughput through the plant. As part of the application, we require a mining plan. There's a beneficiation plan, so they're going to know, is it going to be a 2,000 ton per day plant? Is it going to be a 10,000 ton per day plant? And then you'll know what that throughput is. So if it comes in at 10,000, it's 10%, there's 1,000 tons. If you're dropping below that level, it triggers the need to do something.
The economy will dictate some of that. And at what point does 10% and a little bit more, how long is the mine permit allowed to continue at a little over 10% to keep the permit alive?
Let me back up. I apologize. I said throughput to the plant, but the mine waste unit is where whatever goes to the plant, whatever is not concentrate, that's the metal, ends up in the mine waste unit, so it's 10% of the volume that typically annually goes into that mine waste unit. So say if you're 1,000 ton a day plant, you know, 365 days a year, you can figure out what's going to the tailings facility, mine waste facility, and whatever that number is, then that closure is triggered. Does that help out?
Well, I suspect all the time there's a little bit of gray area there, and I understand that, except that I just wanted your first answer was good for me.
To the wet and the dry and the perpetual treatment. The rule, and there seems to have been great support for when we're finished the mine, when it's closed out, that what needs to be done at the end is just passive, that it's not going to take active wastewater treatment plants or something like that continuing to run into the future. So there seems to be consensus we want to end up with a passive maintenance of that facility. Is that correct from your understanding of all the comments?
Yes.
And so with respect to the pits and the shafts, if they were to naturally fill with water, and if the work done by the licensee were to show that it wasn't going to end up as highly acidic or highly reactive or something like that, then would you feel that would be a good state to leave it in, and that therefore one might not want to call that a wet mine waste unit if wet mine waste units aren't allowed? Am I making myself clear on that? I mean, would it be safe to leave it if you've done the testing and you believe that the pit is pretty much played out, and if it refills with water, that's not going to be a problem, as Mr. Giesler was indicating, in terms of being reactive or highly acidic? Would you feel that that would be a good way to leave it in perpetuity, passively, requiring no treatment?
Boy, that's a big question. I mean, under the hypothetical that you just laid out, I would feel comfortable with that. There's no waste in particular that I'm hearing. There's nothing that is acid producing or metals leaching in that scenario you just described. So yes, I would be comfortable with that.
So where I'm trying to go is to answer this question, if we could, about there's been a lot of comment that all wet waste mine units should be eliminated at closure. And would that mean never allowing a pit to fill? Or do we have to define something in the rule that would say if it naturally fills with water and it's not going to exceed certain chemical characteristics, it would be okay to stay, and that's not a wet waste mine unit that couldn't be left after closure?
I think the issue with the wet waste mine unit, we're looking at the tailings impoundment, okay? And the issue with tailings impoundments is it's a way to continue. You have to build a dam. Essentially, you have a dam structure built. It's usually made with, it's not like a dam, like a Hoover dam that's concrete. It's made with material on site, certain properties, and then typically companies will use the tailings then how it's deposited to build the dam higher, okay? The issue is the failure of that impoundment structure, the actual dam structure, which can cause, it's a catastrophic failure. You've seen them in the news. And that's the push. It's not so much that it's a tailings, it's a dam, how much you got water behind it, how much tails are there. When the embankment goes, what's the risk? Where does it go? The one in Brazil was a tragic, you know, loss of life. 400 kilometers of river impacted right out to the Atlantic. Mount Pauli, British Columbia. So that's the issue, really, with the impoundment, because that's the majority of the mines out there today operate in a slurry type environment. They're using 30% solid, 70%. So that's the issue, is the stability of that dam embankment. How do you, if you walk away, who maintains it? That structure has to be there forever. How do we do that? That was the issue, I think. We used the term wet waste mine unit. That came out of the 91 rules. But the real issue is the stability of that dam, the risk of catastrophic failure, who pays for that when that happens? And a lot of facilities, depending on the type of mineralogy of the deposit, can you do a dry tailings? That might be a better approach. Some facilities you might not be able to mine at all, some deposits, because you're not going to be able to do it with a dry tails. If it's going to be a slurry with an impoundment, it's like, what happens to that impoundment at the end? To me, that's the issue, is the stability of the impoundment structure used to hold the tailings back. And typically, we talked about the floodplain, Jeff will get into that more, but when you do a tailings impoundment, it uses topography. The lay of the land, you want a basin essentially, so if you put a dam in front, you go up the valley. That's typically what your tailings impoundments look like.
So I have a comment to kind of go along with that. I'm thinking of ways with which to determine residence time in the underground situation, and also with regard to tracers that could be used during the excavation of ore, as well as obviously afterwards, to see what the residence is of a particular volume of water before to travel outside the bounds of the mining area. I also got to thinking about, and I can't remember too well on this issue, but it was a number of decades ago that one of the CANDU reactors, nuclear reactors in Canada, had a partial meltdown, ending up with 10,000 curies of radioactivity in the basement of that reactor. And someone decided the best thing they could do was to pump that liquid up elevation-wise, several hundred feet higher elevation, and dump it into a forest of evergreens that are growing on sand. And then someone realized this is not such a hot idea, because sand is very porous and permeable. And my God, the stuff that alpha emitters primarily are going to travel right through the soil down to the nearest river. Well, actually, the alpha emitters did do that, right down to the river. And however, the heaviest of the nuclides that were involved in that didn't go anywhere. And they ended up putting in a tremendous amount of test wells to see where things are going, how long it would take to move. And then basically, as far as I know, they haven't really moved at all, because the sand had a coating of oxide on it that attracted the radioactive nuclides. The only reason I bring that up, we're not talking about radioactivity, but I'm talking about our plans for what will happen when it starts to remove rock, ore, and otherwise, to kind of guess what's going to happen, when guessing may not be such a hot idea in any case, because nature has some very weird ways of working with chemistry in the underground scenario. So I guess all I'm really interested here is something to do, again, as I said, the natural pre-existing groundwater contamination, natural contamination, and a function of what's a residence time. I think it went to Cindy's question there. How long will that stuff sit there before it goes somewhere, and how, anyway, that's about it.
Sure. I think that anything like that is part of what we envision
as part of the background study, that sort of geochemical characterization of the capabilities of the existing media to handle waste would be very typical as part of what we do in characterizing that potential, and certainly how we're going to ultimately define if and when we have a breakthrough or a failure of a treatment system, particularly a natural treatment system. This would be... And certainly we don't deal with radioactive waste, but typically even for any kind of a wastewater spray application system that we do, we look at the capabilities of the soil and the existing system to handle the added nutrient load and how often that material has to be harvested to remove it to maintain the treatment capacity of the soil. So it's not an unusual thing for us to look at all.
Very good. Thank you.
Question is back to you again. I'm looking at the way the rule is currently written, and it would say that, let's focus on the tailings impoundment, a wet tailings impoundment. The rule would currently allow that wet tailings impoundment during the life of the mine, and then when it's closed out, then that would have to be go to some sort of a dry state. Is that correct?
Yes.
Right. And then, but many of the comments we've received, going back to what Mark's comment was, is that even while these things are operating during the life of the mine and it's filled with water, that's where the greatest risk perhaps is of substantial environmental damage. And so the question becomes the trade-off between managing the waste in an impoundment during operations, or trying to do it dry from the beginning. And any comment on that? Because I think that's one of the big issues that would need to be decided if the board wants to make any change in the rule, because right now they could use that impoundment during the life of the mine, but then they would need to close it out and go to dry storage afterwards.
That's correct. I'll offer you some comments on it. Ultimately, it's the board's decision which direction they want to go. We would absolutely be looking at the risk of any design that was submitted to us and determining if that risk was acceptable against the standards that we have. We have put in here provisions for looking at things under pretty severe conditions, the probable maximum flood conditions with regards to overtopping design. The stability assessments are consistent with what we do at all of our facilities now. It's a fairly rigorous standard to look at all of the foundation materials as well as the embankment materials, how things are compacted and constructed. These would be constructed with continuous construction quality assurance oversight. So there's a high degree of knowing how these facilities are being constructed and making sure that they're conforming to standards. That would be done both with department oversight, but continuous construction quality assurance personnel in the field. We've got provisions in there that if they meet the standards and design criteria in here, I'm fairly comfortable that they would be acceptable. But that doesn't mean that we're not looking at each one individually for any peculiarities associated with that particular setting or design.
A little bit along the wet storage again, short of requiring a daily cover like you do for landfills, is it possible to keep a wet storage facility dry? In other words, make it a dry facility until it's capped? Because we do have, 40 inches of rainfall here in the state, and it's acidic rain, a lot of it. Would that require on a daily disposal of waste rock, a daily cover just like we do at landfills?
I don't know necessarily that it would require daily cover, but it's going to require grading to promote runoff. And it would also, in my mind, require continuous reclamation or cover as you got various units to a certain size. You would be putting the final cover on it, so you're not leaving a facility open until the end.
I'd envision a waste rock pile being very difficult to grade from our surface drainage just by the nature of the rubble and the rock that's in there.
That's correct.
So it's not like it's going to be graded like a lawn so the water runs off from it. It's going to go down through the until it's covered. So you're going to have to either import a material that you can grade it from back, or you're going to have to cover it, it seems to me, or the provisions of the regulations have to allow for some kind of a wet storage until it's decommissioned and dewatered, then closed finally. It seems to me it would be a very encumbering operation to try to manage and daily cover that. Whereas if you properly manage it and control the underdrain, and then you do dewater it and seal it and cap it or put a medium over the top, whatever you need for final closure, it seems to me that would be a workable item. We're trying to maintain a dry site in a rainy atmosphere, it would be quite difficult to do.
I would agree that there are going to be challenges. Just talking about a couple of the items you mentioned, if this was a waste rock pile, the permeability of that waste rock would be fairly high. Precipitation would tend to run through that to the collection system on the bottom and be pumped out. So I think in that particular situation, you wouldn't have residence time within the waste rock any significance. I wouldn't consider that a wet unit. That would be a dry unit in that, from that perspective. The tailings themselves, the conventional tailings material, they would, again, you would have to grade that for surface runoff to prevent the infiltration if you were trying to run this as a dry unit. And again, you would close it out in fairly small, discrete areas. The cells would have to be sized appropriately that they were not open that long.
landfill operation.
Correct.
That's what we get now. Thank you.
Dave, could you just explain, I think you've kind of touched on it a couple of times, but could you explain in a little bit more detail kind of the physical, chemical nature of tailings, you know, after the extraction process versus waste rock, and the distinction, just so we're all, so I'm clear and other people are clear.
I think I'll turn to my colleague here.
Very, the tailings are typically like particle size sand or smaller. As I mentioned, you crush the ore. You're trying to liberate the metal from the ore, so you've got to crush it to a point where you can use like flotation with reagents to kind of take the metal out of the rock. What you have left over is sort of, it looks like a beach sand. It's if it's in a slurry type, wet, like I said, it might be only 30% tails, that's sandy tails. As you discharge that out, typically by gravity, it can segregate by itself. You might have coarse tailings at the beginning where the spigot is. The spigot is the outlet, the pipe. Okay, and obviously, as the water comes through, the fines settle out. And then at the end, you have the water up against the impoundment, which typically you have like a decant tower that takes the water out. You either recycle that or run it through the wastewater treatment plant. With the waste rock, it could be, you know, it could be the size of a screen. That would be kind of big. But typically, rock 24, 30 inches probably. It's plastic material. So that's a couple ways that you can deal with that. I've seen in mine disposal of waste rock, essentially what they have done at Eaglemont in Michigan. They actually assumed, they actually tested all the rock, that it was an acid reducer. They actually crush all the waste rock, just like an aggregate quarry, okay? And then they take that material and they backfill the mine. Because it's an underground mine, they're using that waste rock as a platform for each stope. The stope is how they're getting the mining material out. They're backfilling it all with waste rock mixed with cement to make a platform so they can work off, provide structural stability for the next one up above, because they're mining from the bottom to the top. I've seen some waste rock piles actually graded, but usually it's a kind of a uniform particle size, 6 inch, 7 inch, you can crush it down. The problem with crushing sometimes, if you crush something, make it smaller, obviously you have more surface area. If you have more surface area, if it's a reactive rock, you increase the ARD potential. So I've seen in mine disposal, I've seen waste rock backfilled into an open pit. I've seen waste rock piles just covered with a dry cover, soil cover, depending on what it is. But there is a difference between particle size. Waste rock can be anything, you know, inch up higher. Typically, it's going to be whatever the muck pile looks like. And I think it might be a slide. Okay, that's great. Well, thank you. You can see that up. Thank you. On the lower left, where it says waste rock backfill, that's crushed up waste rock being brought into, they call it a backfill plant. Essentially, it's a concrete plant, and they're mixing that waste rock with sand and concrete, taking it back into the decline mine shaft, and using that as the in-mine disposal for structural stability, and so they don't have a waste pile, a waste rock storage area. They actually have a temporary waste rock storage area. I'm going to say go to slide. That's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 now, maybe? Right there. Perfect. Waste rock management. Here's one, covered waste rock pile. That's a great looking pile. It's great. So you know the waste rock had some kind of uniform particle size, okay? Because if it was a mixture of different stuff, you'd see something like this. There's all kinds of different fragments in there. At this particular mine, I said that all the waste rock was taken out. It was placed on a temporary development storage area, which was a lining facility with leachate collection, which you'll see in the upper right. That's waste rock on a liner system. To the lower left, where it says leachate collection sump, that's where we're actually collecting leachate off that waste rock pile. That gets pumped out, and we can see the VJ pump station on the next slide. It's that little white building. They have pumps that go out to the collection area, and that is pumped into a waste treatment plant. So everything comes out right now for that mine. It's held in this area. All the drainage, which would be the rain, snow melt, all that is collected, treated, discharged off-site. But all the rock itself is crushed up, brought back into the mine disposal. And David can help me with this. A lot of times, obviously, you have a swell factor associated with the rock that comes out. Might swell 20-30%, so you may have more material than what you started with once you take it out underground. Dave can talk about. In this case, I think they're actually bringing in material. They didn't have enough to backfill the mine shafts. That is the engineered structure for waste rock. So if we had a waste rock that was reactive, you'd probably see a similar design as you see in this, as far as what I would say slide 2, 3, and 4, not looking at the covered one.
Mark, just one follow-up question. If the rules did not allow waste mine units during the life of the mine, then the tailings would have to be dewatered as they went along. What's the impact of that in terms of wastewater treatment or is the wastewater recycled?
Again, as part of that application process, we do require a mine operating plan, a beneficiation plan. We do require a water balance plan. How much water are you going to use? How do we treat it? There is limitation as far as how much active treatment you have. So if it's a slurry type, tailings impoundment, I think Dave is absolutely correct. You're going to have to do it in small, discrete units. I can't imagine having a 60-acre unit and trying to close it all at once. That would be really, really tough to do. A significant amount of time would be required once to dewater it. And when we say dewater, obviously it's not totally dry, right? You still have moisture content associated with tailings. We did change it from, as far as the time frame for active treatment, down to 10 years. That was based on comments received during the last rulemaking session that we had and comments that we received through a lot of the legislative hearings. It all depends on what they have and how they submit it in the package. I can kind of go through that section of the rule if you want to go line by line, but it's really, they got to tell us what they have, what they're using, what are the risks associated with that, how much time will it take, what's the drainage quality. There's a slew of things they have to submit to us. And if the end of the game says, nope, we're going to need active treatment longer than 10 years, the likelihood of getting a permit will be no. You don't meet that 10-year post-closure standard for active treatment. It's really that simple. The way the rule is written and it's designed to be, some sites it won't be mined. It's really that simple. I don't know, did that help you, Mary? Or am I being...
No, yes, I was just trying to understand a little bit more about some of the risk benefits of...
As I said, I think this...
Or not allowing it at all during the life of the mine.
Pros and cons. I mean, I remember I said it was that spectrum from wet to dry and something in the middle. I mean, some of the comments we see really no tailings and ponds. So where is that line? Somewhere in the middle. Is it 50% solid, 40% solid, 60%? Because I think you can still pump 50-60% solids out by gravity. So where is it? Do we stop here and say we're only going to allow these units from this point up to dry, or are we going to allow the whole gamut? And that's something that the legislature took out and this board has taken out.
You know, that ultimate decision rests with this board and the legislature.
Sure do. Actually, I'd like to turn it over to John now to provide a discussion of groundwater.
Sure. I think particularly given... Okay. That's good.
Back. I think Melanie's going to do a little summarization, then we're going to change our order a little bit and go to public lands because our representative there, he has to leave by noon time. So I want to make sure you can. Melody?
Yes, thank you, Chairman Parker. So just to wrap up before we move on and start thinking about another topic area, as we've said regarding the wet mine waste units, tailings and impoundments, as we've described, what the proposal in front of you currently provides for is storage of Group A, so those are the highly reactive wastes, undercover in a wet mine waste unit. So that's the specific definition of a wet mine waste unit. It's only for the Group A wastes under a water cover, and that is allowed until closure through 10 years post-closure. So no longer, once you're done with closure, those units have to be dewatered and go away. And as we've described, that has been our attempt to address what we understand to be the practical needs for management of the materials on site, but also to address long-term concerns regarding environmental impacts. And so what we're asking the board for is some direction on that. If you can give us some sense as we prepare for our next deliberative session, is that the approach that you would like to see in that rule, or are there some changes that you would like us to try to work out to change what we've got in that draft as it stands today?
Just one quick question on the 10 years. Up to 10 years, who makes it? Would it be on the size of the tailings and so forth to say, okay, on this mine situation, you've got to be closed in 5 years, or is that the decision of the permittee to say that I'm going to use the whole 10 years, whether I do a 100 ton a year or a million ton a year?
Yeah, turn it over to him while I look it up.
I think certainly in the case that it's technologically feasible to close this out sooner, you know, the department would encourage an applicant to the licensing process, but the rule itself provides up to 10 years. So.
It
is up to the applicant, and again, we would certainly encourage a quicker rather than more lengthy closeout, if it was possible.
So I have a question with relationship to that, and that basically is, what if the vast amount of excavation at a given metal mine would be underground, and which would then minimize the amount of rock material that would be part of Group A and everything else, would be minimized by virtue of the fact that you chase the ore body in the state of Maine. It's not a uniform, homogeneous thing that doesn't make any difference which way you go. If you go in any given direction, you have to get something different. And so when you do an open pit mine, I can see in a particular location where there might be a Gaussian structure with some rather valuable metal in it, like gold and other things, that one might want to do, since those are typically located near the top of the ore body, one would want to have an open pit located for that. But in a large copper and sulfide deposit, it's the last thing in Maine that you want to do is try to think you were out in Kennecott Copper in Salt Lake City, Utah, trying to go in this mine. It's all homogenous. Everything's the same in all directions. Things are not all the same in Maine's rock direction, fractures, faults, various other activities that change the orientation. So it's quite possible, I would think, that if one was in the underground mode following the ore body, you take the ore out, you then backfill into those locations as best you can with non-ore rock, and then perhaps you fix that such that it's a dry waste, because you, and now we'll see if that's a question of wet and dry, it's not an under body of water, because water's going to permeate no matter what you get. Even if you concrete it all together again, concrete's rather pervious to water, not like sand or anything like that, but the point is that it can get wet. And it'll stay wet in the rock environment, as wet perhaps as it was before it was ever removed. But so somehow this is suggesting that no matter what it is, your group-based storage is going to be underwater. Well, yeah, that might work well for what you take out of an open pit area, but I don't think it would work so well necessarily. And here again, if you need to go by what the rules are and the statutes are suggesting you have to do, but in reality, to give any permit, you're going to need plans from the operator of the facility how they plan to meet your requirements. And they may decide that they could do one that doesn't have to be necessarily underwater for some other reason, because they found a different technology to be able to stabilize their minimal amount of, I'd call it overburden, but it might even be underburden, because basically just the non-ore material that's not being thrown in a pile outside, but may be necessarily taken right back underground shortly after they've taken the ore out of it. They take whatever's left over and put it back underground and then decide what to do with it. Anyway, I thought your permit process is going to really tell all when they come in and say, here's our plan for doing this and that and that. And that's when you hit them with your expertise and you say, that plan's not going to work. That plan looks like it might very well work. But we were already saying what the plans have to be. You've got to put it underwater. Not sure what that actually means. Anyway, that's what it is.
I got one more problem. You asked us a question.
Yes, I did.
I'm going to answer the question with a question. Okay, that's a real good way to do it. Are you comfortable with the rules you've written that you can properly manage and control the wet storage until it goes to the dewatering stage and becomes dry storage? Are you comfortable with that? Or do you have wording revisions that you think are necessary to give you that power?
I think that the provisions, as Mr. Eisler has described, the requirements that we have in the proposed rule for what applicants will have to provide to us in order to obtain a permit are very robust, and that it will be a significant process for someone to be able to clear the hurdle that's set out in the rule for all the criteria that they will need to be able to affirmatively demonstrate that they are meeting, and that will include, there are design standards, but in addition to the design standards, there are requirements to prevent discharges, all of the requirements that we've gone through, those are all layers upon one another. You know, it's not just one independent of the other. Those are all the requirements an applicant is going to have to meet. And so I think that there is more than enough in there that if someone comes with an application, it's going to be a very comprehensive review process that they will have to survive with the department to get a permit.
So in short, you're comfortable with the wording as it is, gives the department the authority to really take control of it. That's my question. Any other questions?
Similar to that. I don't have any particular suggestions to make. And at this point, I'm generally comfortable with this, and I hate to belabor this point, but it has been a big issue as we've gone through this process. And I don't need a lot of detail here, but we did hear, and we've heard a number of, about these number of cases of these catastrophic failures in other locations. And as much as we like to learn from our own mistakes, it's even better to learn from somebody else's mistake. I guess very briefly, my question would be, you know, as the department, if you folks looked at those cases and said, and looked at our rules and said, you know, can you identify certain shortcomings perhaps in that particular facility, those particular circumstances that would be avoided with the rules that you've generated and produced for us to consider here? So I think I made that, hopefully I made that clear.
I can give you a very generalized answer, and then otherwise I would hand the microphone to an engineer. But as our engineer at the table described, the provisions for requirements for stability to address potential seismic conditions, all of those evaluations would also take into consideration exactly that, those lessons learned. That the expectation is when somebody comes to the table with a permit application, those incidents are very much on the mind of everyone, and they're going to need to demonstrate and go through a thorough analysis with us that those are not the same kind of things that would happen
wonder how long that would have devoted this discussion, how old the roof field on the plans,